Knock me off into the pit here. So, a couple of reminders to all of you before I introduce our final presentation, which will be a treat for all of you. First of all, remember those drink tickets, those coins? We didn't just all give you a raise. You know, we actually, that's for your tickets, and we're not being, as I said earlier, we're not being cheap giving you a dollar for a $5 drink. Each of those is one drink. Or use them for slot machines, whatever you'd like to do. We came up with the idea, and the casino absolutely loved it because they could say, we can use those for slot machines, so great. There's a photo section over, if you want to take pictures with awards, and we have all the different awards already here, sort of blank awards, so you'll be getting your actual awards at your office if you haven't, but you can go there and we can get pictures with your team, with us, Stuart and I will be there, et cetera, so we can do that as well. Also, the party itself, I think the bar opens up about 5:15, 5:20, so as soon as we're done here. And also, the wonderful thing about the final presentation here is it's a great lead-in to our party. Many of you have certainly heard of Kenny Aronoff. He is, John Mellencamp, if you've seen his website, you see this, what do John Mellencamp, Paul McCartney, Ringo Starr, Rolling Stones, Lady Gaga, Bruno Mars, Sting, Bob Dylan, Bruce Springsteen, Bob Seger, Elton John, Johnny Cash, Bon Jovi, on and on, to Smashing Pumpkins, even Meatloaf, B.B. King, Rod Stewart, all have in common, and it's Kenny. Kenny is one of the world's best known accomplished musicians, but he's here today in addition to entertaining all of us, but also explain how self-discipline, hard work, fueled by passion and education has helped him set his goals. He inspires and educates his audience in demonstrating how communication skills are your business and a healthy life is a wealthy life. He motivates and educates by sharing how staying relevant will make it possible to become successful and stay successful in your business. In addition to performing and creating amazing music, he has also been so inspiring in that he has become one of the most sought-after motivational speakers across the country in addition to his music, espousing the 7 keys to a successful life and career. He's always striving to be better and how to keep the tools, your tools in your toolbox to be more successful. Be prepared to be entertained, to be inspired, and to get ready to rock with an exciting end to the program. So they're setting up. I'm going to step off stage here, and when Kenny is ready, we'll start the presentation, which you will truly enjoy. This is a real treat for you guys. So see you later on.
what you really like. Baby, I can take my time. We don't ever have to fight. Just take it step by step. I can see it in your eyes, 'cause they never tell me lies. I can feel that body shake and the heat between your
I was 10 years old and I was outside playing with my brother. My mom screamed, "You gotta come and see what's on TV." So me and my brother came inside and there were the Beatles on TV doing the Ed Sullivan Show.
Well, shake it up, baby. Shake it up, baby. Twist and shout. Twist and shout.
It was almost like a tornado stopped and life just stood still. And I saw the Beatles and I turned to my mom and I went, "Mom, I want to be in the Beatles. Call them up. How do I get in the Beatles?" I've played with everybody. You know, I've had so much success, both live and in the studio. People ask, why Kenny Aronoff? Why do you hire Kenny Aronoff? Why has Kenny been successful?
So let it rock, let it roll. Let the Bible bell come and save my soul. Hold on to 16 as long as you can.
Thank you.
you. Thank you. All right. So dreams come true. They did for me, and they can for you. But what I learned is they don't come true by accident. I made my dreams come true. I mean, I'm a little kid who grew up in a town of 3,000 people. How did I end up with the Beatles, you know? When I was a little kid, me and my brother, my brother, me, and my sister, we would play outside. There was nothing to watch on TV. We had a black and white TV. Color hadn't been invented yet. We had a black and white TV with the rabbit ears and the tinfoil on it, right? To get better reception, maybe we had one or two channels. So we were always outside. Even in the dark, we just played outside. And one day my mom screamed, "You guys got to come in right now." And I thought I was in trouble, you know, which wouldn't be unusual. And there on TV, I was the ADDHGHYZ kid. And on TV, like you saw, there was the Beatles. And I mean, there was nothing, I'd never seen anything like that before. It was like, there was no games or videos or computers. So this was extraordinary. So I seriously went, "Mom, I want to be in the Beatles. You got to call them up. Get me in the Beatles." You know, I was only a little kid. She didn't say anything. And then I saw that drum set. And I went, "I want to play drums," because I was that ADD hyper kid. "I want to play drums." And of course, she didn't say anything then. And finally, I said, "You know what? I want to grow my hair." Anybody see A Hard Day's Night? When you're probably all younger than me. But A Hard Day's Night was like extraordinary. It was like, I want to do that. That's all I wanted to do. Well, obviously, she didn't call the Beatles up. I didn't get the gig, so I started my own band. There I am with hair. And the thing is, you know, I look back at my life now, and the thing is, I heard what she said, but it wasn't acceptable. My whole life has been a door closes on me, and I immediately open up another door. If that closes, I open up another door. There is no no. So I started my own band, played Beatles music. You know what? That's my Beatles. Well, thank you. Eventually, as you saw, I got to play 50 years later. That's the dream coming true. 50 years later, I'm playing with Paul McCartney and Ringo Starr, honoring him for that Ed Sullivan show that 72 million people saw in America, but only four of us got to play with them 50 years later. That's extraordinary. So my whole question is like, why? How'd this happen? And I wrote this autobiography, Sex, Drums, Rock and Roll, and I had to look back at my life because I really don't care about what I've done. I care more about what I'm going to do. You know, I'm sure you guys can relate. It's like, all right, I already sold that house. What's next? I don't have anything on the books. You know, it's that thing. And music is one of the most difficult businesses, you know. So I look back at my career, and I realize there are seven things. I narrowed it down to seven that have made me successful. And tonight I want to share with you guys these seven things. Seven ways I really believe a person can become successful in their life and career. The same seven ways that I have an extraordinary life in the music business, which is so unpredictable for over 3.5 decades. So the first thing is self-discipline. It all starts there. Self-discipline is basically just doing something you don't necessarily want to do, but it gets you the results you want. When I was a little kid, I was into sports, I was into my social life, girls, of course, and I was into rock and roll. But the academic thing I wasn't great at, and so, you know, I'd be the type of kid who'd read through a book and, like, I couldn't even remember what I read. Anybody ever read 30 pages and you go, "Oh, geez, what did I just read?" Well, that was that guy. But in my family, we all went to college. So in my junior year, I had to take chemistry. Chemistry, right? Hard. So I went, "Oh my God, what am I going to do? I got to pass." So I decided, okay, same thing. I said, all right, I got to do the same thing I've been doing, but I got to do it different. So I said, all right, I'm not going to turn the page till I really know what's on this page. Where I'd normally just go, yeah, whatever, formulas, algebra, whatever. And I went to the teacher and got help. The bottom line is I got an A in my first quiz. Then I got an A in chemistry. Now I felt good. See, because now I felt like now the teachers and my parents respected me. I completed my feeling of self-worth. Then I got an A in physics from that same guy. This teacher was like a Marine sergeant. He was not the easiest guy to please. And then I got an A in advanced math, and bam, I had learned self-discipline. And what I've realized is that once you learn self-discipline, you feel that feeling of, all right, I got to do push-ups to get a big pec chest. If I do that, I hate this, but I look great when I'm done. That sort of thing. Self-discipline, you can apply to raising a family. You know, make sure your kid is, you know, doing his homework. Make sure the kid is going to bed on time. Make sure the kid, you know, gets to school on time. Make sure the kid is not watching too much TV. It's that self-discipline, you know. All right, the next thing is it's hard work fueled by passion and education. I mean, hard work to me is just like a vehicle getting somewhere, a car, bicycle, in my case, sometimes a jet. It gets you through life, and the passion is this. What I love playing music and drums is like the gas that goes in it. I love what I do, so I'm very fortunate that I love what I do, so it helps me want to work hard and be disciplined. And the education is a big contribution to this, my success, because to be relevant in the music business for 35 years is huge. You gotta be keep learning. You gotta keep learning, and nowadays even more than ever because, you know, the way the internet is and everything's changing. As a matter of fact, in your world, I was just having a lunch with a buddy of mine who's a real estate guy. He says, man, how's it going? Because, you know, the guy's always making tons of money. He says, not so good right now. I said, why? He said, what's going on? He says, internet. Internet's taking a lot of his business away. People are selling their own houses. So there's an example how you have to stay educated and reinvent yourself to be, stay on top of your game. At 18, I was practicing 8 hours a day for fear when I was gonna go to college, because I studied classical music. There was no rock and roll school. There were no rock and roll mentors for me. So I was studying with the Boston Symphony Orchestra percussionist, because the orchestra was 3 miles from my house. I started with him. He suggested I go to college and be a music major. I thought, that sounds good, because I certainly don't want to be a chemistry major. And so I was a little bit behind on, you know, timpani and mallets and that and orchestral stuff. So I was in fear. I was practicing 8 hours a day. 8 hours a day, 7 days a week. Self-discipline, hard work. And I got into school, and I was the worst guy there. But on Friday and Saturday nights, when everyone was partying, I was practicing until they kicked me out of the building. This was the business model of what's made me successful. And in that 1 year, I knew I wasn't at the greatest school, but I decided I got to get out of here. I got to go to the top three was Eastman, Juilliard, and Indiana University. So I apply to Eastman because it's just right up the road in Western Mass in Rochester. I apply, I get in, but they won't accept me because they didn't have a slot. In other words, I was good enough, but they wouldn't let me. Ah, damn. But there was this hot cellist, and she was a junior, and I heard her talking about she's going to Aspen, which is run by Juilliard, one of the other top two. I went, all I want to do is I want to go where she was going. So I auditioned. I auditioned, and here's how I auditioned. They say, learn three different, do three different performances out of the four areas, like timpani, mallets, snare drum, and multiple percussion. Well, I did all four because I wanted to make sure, you know, extra credit. So I don't hear from them. So I'm going to, that summer, I'm going to play in a rock band and take lessons. The day I leave school, I went, oh, I forgot my mail. I went, go back, I get it, and it's, oh, someone sent me a check. I open it up, accepted to Aspen. Life-changing. 2 weeks later, I'm in Aspen. Worst percussionist there. Everybody's from Juilliard, and I'm learning scales, and they're playing like concertos. Humiliated by conductors. But the teacher there was from Indiana University, the number one school in the country. And he was so deep up here, and my intuition said, I got to go where he goes. I got it. Not only is he a good teacher, but he's deep up here. So I said, I want to audition to Indiana. He says, come back in January. I said, no, I want to audition for Indiana now. He says, no, come back. You know, I says, no, I want to audition now, this summer. Long story short, I audition, I get in. Now I'm at Indiana University. And this will freak you out. I had hair. And those are some of the things. You know, I was practicing. I worked my way from the bottom to the top. And while I was there, the number one student orchestra in the country is at Tanglewood, which is run by the Boston Symphony Orchestra. So I got to go there. I mean, that's where I'd get to play with Leonard Bernstein as a conductor.
Seiji Ozawa, Aaron Copland as a conductor, you know, and it was just like, that is the elite group, and you're mentored by the Boston Symphony Orchestra. I audition, I fail. Next year, I audition, I fail. Third year, I audition, strike three. I went, oh man. I went, I can't say the word, but you can imagine what I was thinking. I'm going back again, and I got in. I got in. Can you believe that? It's like, the thing is, there is no no. When someone says no, you just go, okay, that's no to you, but I'm going to still do this. There's never a no. It's hard not to freak out and go, because it's actually easier to say when someone says no, you go, okay, I don't anymore. Now, I got a story coming up that'll be perfect for this. So I get in, so this third thing, creating a plan they execute. All right, I call this the American dream, what I did. Went to college, studied a trade, and then I got a job in that field that I studied. I got into the Jerusalem Symphony Orchestra and Quito, Ecuador, which is huge because there aren't that many orchestral openings. I get it, and I reject it because I still wanted to be in the Beatles. I still wanted to be in the Beatles. Mom? No. Wow. Everybody could not believe it. I'd risen to the top. So what I did, check this out. I was willing to play in a club for $75 a night when I got a gig, study with a teacher in Boston, drum set, teacher in New York, drum set, and practice 8 hours a day at home, back at home. It was a little bit humiliating, but I was following my passion. A year later, a bunch of guys in Indiana convinced me to come to Bloomington to start a band, get a record deal, go on tour like the Beatles. Seemed like a great plan. And I was executing it. Practice, 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 work hard. And there's the band. Right there, Stream Winner. All right. After 3 years, we didn't get a record deal. So now what? I'm going to move to New York. I'm 27. It's not, I got to do something. I'm going to move to New York. I know more people there than not. I'm in this restaurant eating dinner because a friend of mine invited me to audition for Lou Rawls. I had 2 days to prepare. I know Lou Rawls isn't the coolest, but he had sold 40 million records back then, and I figured if I get that gig, I could live in L.A. L.A., New York, Nashville, the three centers of music, after Detroit, of course. And so I'm eating in this restaurant. I'm all nervous. I'm like, oh, man, I got to get going. And I went, nah, just chill for a second. Chill. Just relax, man. And because I was nervous because about this audition. I leave the restaurant, I bump into this girl, Ruthie Allen. I can picture myself right there, singer-songwriter. I told her what I was doing. She says, hey, you know this Johnny Cougar guy? I went, yeah, he just fired his drummer last night. I went, Johnny Cougar? And I went, wait a minute. He's on this new TV show called MTV. And he's on the radio and he's touring with kids. I started panicking. This is my Beatles. Oh my God, he's doing it. What am I thinking? Went to a payphone with a quarter because there were no cell phones. I call up Mike and I go, Mike, this is Kenny Aronoff. He was a guitar player in the band. I want to audition. He says, call me in 2 weeks. I don't get the Lou Rawls gig. I'm back in Indiana. And I'm like, Mike, I want to do this. I'm thinking, this is what I got to do. It's right here. I don't have to move to New York. I'm right here in Bloomington. So they said, John, check me out. Because of self-discipline, hard work, I was known as the bad mofo in Bloomington. So I get the audition. What I did was I didn't understand the drummer's playing so simple, and I was used to playing so many more notes. I went, all right, I just wrote everything down from my training in classical music. I could write every note down, memorize it, practice 6-8 hours a day. I was loving it. I was digging the power. I show up at John's place with my dad's car that I'd bought for $500, leaking oil on his pavement. I got this humongous drum set, and John wants like the Ringo Starr drum set, you know, just four pieces. He sees that, and I'm dressed not cool. I'm not dressed like this. This is cool, right? So I'm not, and John just looks at me, and I come out and say, hey, man, what's happening? With my personality, he just goes, John Mellencamp. He turns around. I'm like, wow. Set up the drums, crush the audition, destroyed. I broke cymbal sticks. And then he goes upstairs and yells for Mike. And then Mike comes back down and says, as I'm packing, he goes, welcome to hell. I went, yeah, what? I was excited, but I was, what do you mean by hell? I found out later. So I, basically, there is John Mellencamp, that's a pigsty for a video we did on the Aha record. So I had executed my second plan. You know what I mean? I was now in a rock band. My dream came true. Not so fast, folks. 5 weeks later, we have to go to L.A. to make a record. I tell everybody I'm going to L.A., staying at the Chateau Marmont. You know, there's Meryl Streep in the elevator with me, young and skinny. And then De Niro. I run into De Niro. And then you know, just rock stars, and Belushi died there. And it was like, we're on Sunset Strip. It's like, yeehaw. 2 days in the studio, band meeting. And I went, I don't like this feeling. Weird. Come down. John says, you're not playing on the record. And he's going, well, you haven't had enough experience. And I'm going, no. And then everybody was like shocked. That'd be like saying to a Marine sergeant, no, after he told you to do 10 push-ups, and or 100 or 1,000, whatever they do. So I said, and then I start, I didn't realize I was a fight or flight guy. I really was like, no, I'm not going home. I was embarrassed. And I was like, wait a minute, I just played with Leonard Bernstein and won this concerto competition. How can I can play this? He says, well, you haven't had enough experience playing on records that get on the radio. He was right. I didn't think that. I was like, BS, I can do this. So I'm now trying to negotiate. He's firing me, and I'm saying, you can't fire me. Think about that. How many times have you told somebody when you've been fired, no, you can't fire me? I had to come up with something a negotiation that would benefit us both. So I said, well, you know, fumbling, am I still your drummer? And he went, what? I said, am I still your drummer? He said, yeah. I said, well, I'll go to the studio and I'll watch those drummers, session drummers, play my parts, and I'll benefit, or I'll learn from them, and then I'll benefit from that. And then you're going to benefit because I'm your drummer. And you don't have to pay me. That was the thing that kept me in L.A. You don't have to pay me, and I'll sleep on a couch. I may have even said the floor. He did not pay me, and I slept on a bed. But the bottom line is, he said no, and I said no back. That's the cool thing. There's always, when a door shuts, another door opens. And if they shut that door open, there's always another way. Even if it takes time, you get your way eventually. So I didn't know this about myself. I was just working on instinct. I go home, practice 8 hours a day, of course. I'm back to the 8 hours, put together. All I'm thinking is I'm going to make the next record. I got to make the next record. Took a year and a half till we even started the next record. We do this record, hardest record I've ever made out of the 300 million records I've been on sold. That's how many records I've been on without downloads. This is the most difficult record, but the most important record. We go in the studio. Two guys get fired. I almost get in a fist fight with John. We're there for 9 weeks. Felt like I was in Vietnam. And one day, there's this song called Jack and Diane. I'm sure you guys, right? Dude, that was off the record. That was gone. Nobody knew what to do with it. Because it was a balance. Like, dude, we were just doing this little beat. You know, a little ditty about Jack and Diane. We didn't know what to do with it. It's like having a house and you don't know how to decorate it. And if you don't decorate it right, nobody wants it. That's what we didn't know how to do with Jack and Diane. So the Bee Gees were next door, and there was this kind of like drum machine sequence going on. And this was like back in 1801, so, you know, it was new. So somebody walks in with this drum machine. I'm like, what's that? Give me that thing. I'm like, you're not replacing me with that. And they said, yeah, John wants that. I'm like, give me that. So I take control and try to program this drum beat I was playing. Like, instead of the bass drum, I programmed a tom-tom. And instead of a snare drum, it was a hand claps. And instead of hi-hat, it was a tambourine. And then I go into the lounge, and I'm playing pool. And all of a sudden, I get a yell. Aronoff, get in here. I'm like, what? He says, we need a drum solo. I'm like, on a ballad? Okay. I didn't know what my purpose was with John Mellencamp. I didn't even know that question until 4 years ago. What is the purpose of a drummer? What is the purpose of whatever you do, right? See, once I figured out, once you know what your purpose is, everything you decide, think, breathe, talk, dress, anything, goes down through that purpose. The purpose of a drummer, obviously, is you gotta play the right beat to a song, you gotta keep time, because otherwise the band is all over the place. You gotta play with feel, because your feel affects the band, which affects the audience. You're the engine. And that's your foundation, like a cake. And then the fourth thing is you be creative. You add fills and cymbal crashes, but without messing up the foundation. That's pretty obvious. But the big purpose, I didn't know, is to get John's song on the radio to be number one. Because if it's number one, he makes millions of dollars. If I got hired by Microsoft, they don't hire me because they like me. They want me to make millions of dollars for them. I am an employee to the employer, John Mellencamp. It may look like a band, but he's the boss. My job was to get number one records on the radio so he could be a gazillionaire. And I didn't even think that way. I didn't even know. I was just thinking, I just want to be on the record. But that's the big picture. So now I'm at that point. What am I going to play to make this song get on the radio? Which, by the way, did go to number one. It did. So, yeah. So we set up the drums, and we get this big drum sound, which was a very new thing. You used to record drums in little rooms, and this is a big room. And then it's time for me to play. So I go, okay. I'm starting to learn the language of playing with John Mellencamp. Simpler. So I do this thing, boom, blam. Bass drum, snare drum. Boom, blam. On my entrance, and I stop. And they're all going, yeah, they like it. So I still have my job. Then, well, remember, I got fired on the other one. So I'm doing this stuff, and I don't remember what happened, what transpired, but I end up back in the control room. And everyone's going, well, you should do this, you should do this, and you should do this, and you should do this. And I'm going, wow. I'm thinking, okay, I got to hear what everyone's saying. I'm thinking, and then try to come up with my own idea, because the bottom line is I've got to go out there and save my career. And I'm walking back, I remember thinking, I got 35 feet to save my career. I've got 20, 25, I'm like, oh my God. I gotta come up with something here. So I'm on the drum set, and everybody usually goes around the tom-toms, you know, they go around from high to low. And I'm sitting there going, you know what, I'm gonna do something different. That's starting to become my theme, isn't it? I'm going to go up the tom-toms from low to high. And I do this thing, and they're like, no. I'm like, oh, no. When I get back to the drum set, I'm like, what am I going to do? And I didn't really know. And then suddenly, out of desperation, I thought, all right, take the same idea, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Same idea, but let's, like, put a twist on it. It's like putting furniture in a house and just move stuff around. You go, that's it. That's brilliant. All you had to do is move a few things. All I did, I don't know how I came up with this. If I told you, I don't know. I just don't know. I just went, start it an eighth note later. The same rhythm. Instead of on the beat, you go, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Next thing, before I could even look up, John's hitting the talk back button. The chrome says, hit a cymbal crash. I went, okay, and then I decided to go down the tom-toms, kind of emulating Phil Collins in the air tonight. And then I went, uh-oh, I'm out of drums. I had a little bit more to go, so I played a triplet. And that's what this turned into.
Oh, yeah, I say life goes on long after the thrill of living is gone.
So, it's getting a little warm up here, folks. Don't worry, no more is coming off. So, that record went to number one. I had 34 gold platinum records. All of a sudden, who's Kenny Aronoff? Now it's like, wow, who is Kenny Aronoff? I'm number one. I was became, you know, the new guy, but I was scared to death because can I do this again? I'm like, I don't think I am number one. I was in the same room that I got fired on that one record when I found out I went to number one. And I was like scared. I was like, I'm not really number one. Can I do this again? Well, we did four more records over 8 years. We do rehearse for a record, record a record, do promotion, rehearse for tour, go on tour for 2 year period, take a month off and start again. And that's what we did. And just to give you a little bit of entertainment right now, I'm going to play you five Mellencamp songs purely as entertainment. Some of the songs you should recognize in honor of, you know, me launching my career, basically. And then there's a bar over there we should all go to. I gotta plug in first so I can hear it. Here we go.
Town. time.
I got more to play. So we become huge and very successful. And of course, as life goes, John decides, I quit. And I'm like, why would you quit when flying in private jets, staying at Ritz-Carlton's, selling out like places like the Palace? It's like, I'm like, see, I was just a drummer. He was the boss, so he was stressed. And he had $30 million in the bank. I had just gotten divorced, and I had 5 months' worth of money saved because I was an employee, not the employer. No disrespect to John whatsoever, but I was a hired gun. So I couldn't just sit on my butt. So I thought, woe is me. The glass is empty. What am I going to do? And then I went, no, and in the end, the glass is always full. That's the lesson here. The glass is always full. Because when one thing ends, when one door shuts, the other opens. You've got to think that way. Of course, I was devastated at that moment. I went to L.A. That's what I did. I went to L.A., and I started going to sessions. I was good at recording, but I hadn't really made a career out of it. I'm in L.A. banging around, and I finally one day run into a very significant person, Don Was, from Detroit. So, yeah, it gets better, you guys. First record he asked me to record is Iggy Pop from Detroit. Don goes to the Grammys, wins 3 Grammys for Bonnie Raitt and Love Shack. And then he says, dude, I just got a call from Bob Seger from Detroit. So now I'm playing with Bob Seger and eventually toured with him in 96. Man, my life is turning around. I make it, I've got another career. Here's some pictures of me. This is, I'm a very meticulous chart writer. I write every note out. People make fun of me, but when I've written it out, I could play straight right away. One take. This is me in a recording session with probably a hangover. So, anyway, my life is kicking butt. I eventually end up putting two drum sets in Nashville, two drum sets in New York, two or three in LA, and people are flying me all over the world for just one song even. The budgets were big too, which since then are gone. But needless to say, I'm a happy guy. I had executed a third plan. I had created a new plan and I executed it. This is number three in my life. And I thought the glass was half empty. That's my office, that's just a sample. I mean, it's ridiculous. thank you. This is, I'm not trying to impress you, I'm just trying to give you a little bit of background, you know, what it looks like in my house. So, you know, by the way, you know, my book's called Sex, Drums, Rock and Roll, The Hardest Hitting Man in Showbiz. My mom was like, why are you calling it that? I said, well, I could have called it Sex, Drugs, Rock and Roll, but I thought we'd leave the drug part out. And I just love the way that sounds. Just, you know, sex, drums, or Sex, Drugs, Rock and Roll is like, yeehaw! Let's have a great time. It's not to be taken literally. It's an excitement. And that's what my life's been, is exciting. And anyway, the part that wasn't put in the book, that's the stuff you should probably ask me about. That's the cool stuff, the real good stuff. Anyway, I'm going to play a medley of songs I recorded with. Most of these are number one hits. And here we go. Well, let me make sure I got this right. drug clinic. Why didn't you stop me? Yeah, let me try it again. Let me see what happens here. Did you hear that? Any music? Any music? No music? Oh, wow. I'm going to keep playing it until I don't understand why. Let's see what's going on here. No music? Oh, bummer. You know what? There's so much great music you're missing. We'll get it fixed. You know, there's a statement that I always tell myself, and kind of applies to this. I'll never be as great as I want to be, but I'll spend the rest of my life trying to be as great as I can be. Right? That's like a running back. This is kind of like the blocker didn't block me, and then another guy hit me and the ball came out. It's not my fault, but I fumbled the ball. But I wait till I get the ball again, and then I'm going to score a touchdown. Because I will score a touchdown, right? I mean, this stuff happens, and you just got to push through. It's like, no, 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 I'm going to do this. So I'm going to try this again. Here we go. Nothing? Wow, I'm hearing it, so it's got to be coming out of here to you guys because I'm hearing it. That's the right stuff. So it's got to take these cables off because maybe they're putting pressure on that or something.
You had it before, right?
Yeah, it's been. Okay, I'm going to do something else. Check this out. I'm going to go to a different song. I'll go back to the Mellencamp thing that worked. All right, let's see if this. Do you hear that? No? All right, so that means he's got it? What was it? All right, do you guys, are you ready to rock? Okay, this means that we can go all night. Wow, I'm so sorry you had to watch me play a simple drum part to nothing. That's almost as bad as me dancing without any music. All right, here we go. Jeez. One more time. Let's rock. Free drinks. Free drinks for the people. So I'm going to reboot. I'll reboot this Pro Tools thing. All right, let's see what we got here.
That's a good question.
I have no clue. All right, here we go. All right, no worries. Here we go. Let's see if you can hear this. I'm hearing it here, so it can't. It's got to be going to this. It's going to this box. Can we bypass the direct boxes?
Not really. There's
okay.
Nothing to bypass it to unless I go to the video.
All right. You know what? You continue to work on that. I'm going to continue talking. Is that cool?
Yeah, go for it.
Just keep hitting that button. All right. I'll just move on and pass. The music, that's entertainment. Okay, so, all right. So why, let's just imagine I played all these big hits. It was, I'll tell you, it's That Thing You Do by Tom Hanks. I'll Do Anything for Love, But I Won't Do That by Meatloaf. Avril Lavigne song that went to number one, and Blaze of Glory by Bon Jovi. Yay! So the question now is like, why Kenny Aronoff? Somebody asked that in an interview with me, why Kenny Aronoff? And I was like, what are you talking about? Basically, they're saying, why do they hire you and not anybody else? A lot of drummers. And Don Was, my buddy from Detroit, said the statement in an interview in the New York Times that was written about me. They said, why do you hire Kenny Aronoff? He said, because I want him in the room next to me. He motivates the room. He's a team player. He has saved my sessions. That's what he said. He has saved my sessions. And what he's saying is that it's not that I'm a good player. It's my whole vibe. It's the way if I see somebody in trouble, I'm there for them. I'm thinking about the team, about how every, because if the vibe's good in the room, it's good for me too. I mean, this is why Bill Belichick and the Patriots, 21-3, came back. Dude, who does that? That guy's been coaching teamwork for 365 days a year, so he gets guys that think that way. They're in the locker room, and they're not thinking, whoa, it's me. They're thinking, okay, what can we do now? Door closes, another one opens. What can we do? Spread the offense out. Wear out the defense. Of course, Atlanta kind of blew it, but, you know, he came up with something. I was just with Bill Cowher from the Steelers, and I sort of mentioned the Patriots, and his head went down and went, oh, yeah, you guys had to play him every year to get into the Super Bowl. Anyway, the thing is that this has been a huge thing. Look at this. You know who these guys are, Zeppelin, right? Best rock and roll corporation, except for the Beatles. These guys, who could you replace? Robert Plant? I don't think so. Jimmy Page, you played all the guitar licks. John Baum, the greatest rock and roll drummer ever. And then John Paul Jones, who came up with all the arrangements and ideas. Each one of these guys was crucial in making that sound. You know, it's like I always ask you, are you the bass player in your office? Are you the guitar player? Are you the drummer? How are you? Michael Jordan couldn't win those games without his teammates. And what made him dangerous was he was a team player. You're standing in front of him, and you're thinking, oh, my God, is he going to shoot, dribble, or pass? But you knew no matter what he was going to do, it was going to be the right thing for the team. That's a very powerful person. So this is what's made me very, very successful. Here's some people. There's me and Slash. I'm not trying to brag, but I'm just showing you the difference in personalities. Look at this switch. He liked me. He actually liked me. And then, Jim, I could go toe-to-toe with craziness. Now, that's Billy Corgan, lead singer of the Smashing Pumpkins. I got the gig with the Pumpkins. I flew from L.A. to New York and auditioned for 35 minutes. He walks in. He says, hi, Kenny. Nice to meet you. Picks up a guitar. He says, all right, we know how to play hard and fast. I want to play more trippy. I'm like, sure, whatever you want. I'm like, trippy cymbals, little tom-toms. I'm thinking, we got to get into a beat here. So I get into a thing. We get into a thing. We do this thing. We end it. And here's what got me the gig. I didn't know it at the time, but I went, well, is there anything I could do to make it better for you? He smiled and went, sure, just play more of the same thing. Next day I got a call. Knowing his personality, that was a big reason why I got the gig, is because he thought, I can work with this guy. That's why I got the gig. There's plenty, there was other drummers there, but he went, I can work with this guy. Well, yeah, I can work with that guy. That guy. Okay, Styx, all right. Styx, they've only had two drummers, and then the drummer had a baby, and they needed someone to fill in. First of all, I can write charts out, but one of the biggest reasons why they wanted me on that week tour was because I'm easy to work with. I'm a team player. I didn't come in and go, like, I've made all these records, and I've done all these tours. I came in like, I'm in your house. Where should I sit? And when it came down to play, I kicked some serious booty, but meanwhile, I was respecting them, and they knew that about me, and they wanted me, not the other 1,000 drummers that could have done it. Okay, this is a super group here, Chickenfoot. Does anybody know that band? You should, because one of the members is from Detroit. He's not in there, though. Chad Smith. The drummer from the Chili Peppers, yeah, Chad is in Chicken Book. It's a super group. Sammy Hagar is on the far left. Lead singer Van Halen, Ronnie Montrose, Sammy Hagar, and Chicken Foot. Joe Satriani, one of the most virtuosic guitar players. And then Michael Anthony, the bass player from Van Halen. And then me. Chad couldn't do it because he had to do his day gig with the Chili Peppers, making $8 billion a day. And he said, Kenny's your guy. Check this out. Sammy calls me up. Goes, Kenny, there's a lot of guys. There's a lot of guys. See, you guys, I'm hearing it in here. That means it's going to there. It's not going from here to the.
We got some songs, not all of them.
Yeah, it's just that.
Some songs are working, some are not.
Well, I don't know why that is. Okay. Oh, maybe it is a technical thing. Yeah. Is the Buddy Rich thing there?
Yeah,
well, I'll just play that one. We're moving on. All right, so Sammy calls me up, and he wants to know. He says, Kenny, there's a lot of drummers who want this gig. I want somebody that I can get along with. You know, he made $100 million in selling Cabo Wabo tequila. So he doesn't need the money. He's got his own private jet. He said, I don't need a tour. I just want to have fun. And he was trying to find out if we could get along and be on the band. You remember, you're only on stage for an hour and a half, so the other 23 and a half hours, you're not on stage, you're hanging out. And he likes to have dinner afterwards with the band and hang out. That was a big key thing. So I said, you know what, Sammy? Let's get together. I'll come up to your house, we'll hang out, we'll play, and if you like me, I'll join the tour. He liked me. All right. I get somebody to help me with this, but this looks like there's a moat between us. I'll just tell you the story. I could almost jump down there. That'd be a great closer, right? So this story is about me and Bill Clinton. So I'm playing at the Ford Theater, which is where Abraham Lincoln got shot, and it's a variety show. So there's like jugglers, actors, we're the rock band. I'm playing with Fogerty and a magician. And at the end, there's a semicircle on the stage, and Bill Clinton's right there. And let me add, peak of the Monica Lewinsky incident. So I'm like, whoa, he's the president, but that's also that guy. So I'm in the semicircle, and Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton come by. And I'd done it the year before at Bon Jovi, and I was like, I was nervous. I mean, it's the president. President, most powerful man in the world. I'm shaking his hand. Coolest guy in the world. This year with Fogerty, he goes to David Copperfield, then he comes back to us, and he's hanging with us rockers. And I just went, I couldn't help myself. I went, Mr. President, dude, I was just in L.A., and I was just in New York doing recording sessions, and everybody wanted me to tell you they love you. They think you're the bomb. They want me to tell you they love you, and they support you, and blah, blah, blah. He smiled and grabbed my hand, shook it, put his other hand on my forearm, pulled me in close, and kissed. No, he didn't. He pulled me in close, and he didn't, like, talk in my ear. He looked at me, and he went, smile, went, you know, they've been trying to get me out of office for 6 years. It ain't going to happen. It ain't going to happen. I went, wow. I look over his shoulder, and all the secret, there was probably like 80 red dots on me. But the Secret Service were all looking at me, and at the after party, people came up to me and was like, hey, you guys are great, man. How long have you been doing this? Hey, what'd the president say? I went, nothing, not a thing. But my whole point of the story is the communication skills. Is that he what's up? He liked me. What I said to him made him feel like, oh man, I like this guy. I have to deal with these other people. This guy's telling me something nice right now. He liked me. He wanted to hang with me. And I reminded him of that story years later when we were at some party, and unbelievable. So this is where this team communication skills is huge. And it makes my career very successful. Okay, RPS. RPS is basically, the repetition of something will prepare you for success. Anything. There's this guy, Jason Day, the PGA golfer. He won 7 PGA tournaments in 10 months last year, and they asked him, how'd you do that? Self-discipline, hard work, and this RPS. He didn't call it RPS, I'm calling it. 6 hours a day, 2 hours on the drive, 2 hours on the chip, 2 hours on the putt, 7 days a week. 6 hours a day, 7 days a week, got him to become that great. Guess what? Kept doing it while he was that great. That's how you stay successful. What happens, and I have a buddy who goes to corporations and is trying to help corporations in this manner, where people, they get the gig and then they just kind of relax a little bit, or this attitude, they stop doing the things that got them where they are. In my business, the fear of the business keeps me constantly going. I just never stop. And that's why I'm still here. RPS, repetition is a preparation of success. Lifting weights, anything you do, thinking, reading, anything, I apply that to everything. My diet, anything that I want to be good at, I just say, you repeat it, you repeat it, you repeat it, you repeat it, and away you go. Would that come? So it's coming out of there. Is it working now? What'd you do? All right. You guys want to go back and hear the sessions for entertainment? All right, we'll do that and see what happens. If it stops, so whoever, you wave at me if it go like that, if it's not happening. Okay? All right, good. I mean, I don't want to make a fool of myself three times. All right, here we go. It should go to my headphones. Should be going to my ears. Go up higher. See if there's. Put that to main out. Put main out. Put it to main out. It was your phone? No, it's supposed to go. The whole thing should go out. All right. Put the. It's got to go to my phone now. Here, look at this. Let's go to this. This is a model. See, there's the stereo. There's the phones right there. See, hold on, let me go in here. Got it? Go to the phones, but it's gotta be, and then up top it's gotta go to the phones.
Always do.
We did it together, right? Okay. So the next thing I want to talk, six, we're almost done here. Healthy life is a wealthy life. Everything that I've talked about is useless unless we're healthy, mentally, physically, and emotionally. So you can see I'm pretty good shape for being 900 years old and going strong. So people ask me all the time, you know, well, how do you do this? How do you do this? So I came up with something that I'll share with you. It's just basically eight things. All right, weight training. Weight training is not just to look like Arnold Schwarzenegger, but lifting weights. The main thing about lifting weights, besides being strong, is it brings your hormone levels up, or keeps your hormone levels up. And the hormone levels being up fights off heart disease, diabetes, and cancer, the big three, along with everything else. It just makes you healthy, keeps you young, and makes you healthy. Cardio, biggest thing is that exercise is the biggest and most important muscle in your body, the heart. And, you know, that's a no-brainer for me. I'll do that because, you know, when the heart goes, I hear you die. So cardio and weight training are crucial. Stretching is just me being flexible. I have to be flexible to do what I do. And you don't want to be like walking like this, you know, when you're 40. Diet, it's not what you eat, it's what you don't eat that's crucial. First of all, let's go to what you eat. I always just tell people, man, increase your vegetables. Vegetables build your immune system up and antioxidants. This is a salad my wife made for me. I'm just trying to show you. I mean, that looks good and tastes good. All right, so I won't get into basically processed foods and sugar. Like, you know, I was looking at a drink the other day. Someone sent me this super healthy drink. One of the cans had 2 grams of sugar in it. The other ones had 33 grams. That's bad. The sugar feeds cancer cells. It's like a war going on in our body. The good guys and the bad guys. White cane sugar, processed foods feed believe it or not, actually feed and strengthen the bad guys. So, but that doesn't include booze. Booze you can drink, that kills the bad guys. Come on, Jesus. That's a no-brainer, right? I didn't need to tell you that, but I just thought I'd reinforce it since we're about to start drinking. So diet is a big part. I eat chicken, fish, and red meat, but I just less portions and try to increase the vegetables all the time. And I use fruit as my... People saw me last night eating at dessert. I had a bowl of berries. Super antioxidants. My breakfast is this. Coconut milk with no sugar, okay? Not juice. Juice is loaded with sugar. Anything that says concentrate is bad. So coconut milk without sugar, whey protein, super green food, which has got all the fruits and vegetables to boost you in the morning. And then I put a scoop of peanut butter for fat, which cuts your appetite down, and the cup of berries also cuts your appetite down, and you're getting antioxidants. That's it. Blend it up. Do that. That's next. And then if I'm hungry in an hour or something, I'll have a poached egg on some toast. You know, one poached egg. And then I continue through my day with, you know, eating the way I was talking. All right, supplements. I take supplements because I travel so much and I can't be guaranteed, I'm going to get the greatest food, and I'm traveling all over the world. I was just in India. I don't know what they're going to feed me. So I bring, like, I have a multiple vitamin with massive amounts of B complexes and antioxidants and immune booster stuff, and I take 4,000 milligrams of fish oil, which is good for, I mean, everything in your body, including your hair, which obviously isn't working on me. Well, I do grow it here. So... And so I take fish oil, I take a lot of vitamin D3, which is an immune booster, basically it's like taking like a flu shot. So these are the type of things I take. Now water feeds every single organ in your body. Without water, you're dead. 3 days, you're gone. Well, you can eat, not have food for 40 days. Water, you should drink half your body weight in ounces. So if you weigh 200 pounds, drink 100 ounces of water. I told you I got through chemistry. 100 ounces of water every day. Sometimes when I'm tired, I'll drink 2 glasses, 8 ounces of water, and I wake up. Water is huge. Sleep, this is where I'm a little bit weak on, but the magic number now is 7 hours. Sleep is where your body and your brain repair. They're even saying, I don't know how they figure this out, but your brain actually gets rid of matter or something. But sleep is the way your body repairs. Now, I wake up after 4 hours, but then I'll go back for an hour, and then I'll wake up and go back for a half hour, and I'll stay in bed until I get that seven, you know, except for last night. Meditation, the thing about meditation is it's just a stress release. And even if you do 5 or 10 minutes, it calms me down. Stress is bad, and stress makes you sick. So there's my 8 things. I live by them. And the last of my 7 ways to be successful and stay successful is to stay focused and relevant. And man, do we all know how that's affecting us. In all our businesses, we got to stay relevant, man. It's not a joke. The internet, social media, whatever you have to do to stay relevant, because what's the choice? What choice do we have? It's either stay relevant or you're out of the game. And if you get out of this game, you're going to have to get into another game and be relevant. I've had to stay focused. Listen, they used to fly me all over the world. That's my studio. I had to spend $100,000 and get all this fancy equipment so I could sound like Kenny Aronoff. I didn't want to do that. I had to move from Indiana to LA, pay twice as much for everything because I had to relocate to stay relevant. You know, and look, who would have thought the LP would go, then the CD, and the CD go, and then downloading, and then the music's free. And now there's no income source. So there's no way for a company or a record company to reinvest in the talent to make more money to sell more records. Nobody buys records. The business is like the horse and buggy business, you know. But I'm kicking butt. Somehow I'm the guy kicking butt. All right. This is being relevant. I wrote Sex, Drums, Rock and Roll. I didn't even want to write the book. Somebody convinced me to write it. They were interviewing me for a Joe Satriani book. The guy's good to write your book. I'm like, no, I don't have time. I don't have time. No, well, I'll write it. You know, you just dictate to me. I went, it's too much work. I knew it was going to be. 4 years later, folks. And I literally had a checkbook in my hand at one point after my writer had interviewed, you know, Bon Jovi and Mellencamp and Billy Corgan and John Fogerty and Melissa Etheridge. I'm like, this book stinks, man. How much does it cost for me to buy it back and bury it? And he went, whoa. He said, just take it easy. He says, we're going to get an editor. And I says, well, what is that going to do? He says, well, first of all, the book's 600 pages, is supposed to be 300. We'll chop it down and we'll make it like a movie. Like when they film a movie, they film a billion hours and they only use 1,000, you know. I didn't know the process. Anyway, I wrote a book. It's a killer book. It's basically about a kid, you know, saw the Beatles and end up playing with it. It's about a workaholic. It doesn't matter if you're in music or in business. It's about being that running back that just keeps pounding in the end zone. The door closes on you, open up another one over and over and over again. And that's what I wanted to share with you tonight. This is about being successful in any field. My story just happens to be music and drumming. And now I'm already starting another book. And this book only came out in November. And this book is going to be it's going to be called The Kenny Aronoff Experience, 7 Ways to Be a Rock Star in Your Life and Career. So I've never really been intimidated by anybody. I've been nervous because, you know, when you're a drummer, you don't want to mess. If you make a mistake as a drummer, everybody knows. It's embarrassing. So as a kid, I was always nervous, and I don't get nervous anymore. If I make a mistake, I say, I meant to do that. I meant to do that. This is not a mistake. I'll do it again. But I was intimidated by my uncle. I had an uncle, Nat. This guy was a Golden Gloves boxer, a Navy pilot, self-made man. He was broke. My mom's brother, their dad left them when they were little. They had no money. They were poor. He became a millionaire in the 70s, had planes, boats. And he was over at our house at Thanksgiving. He's doing one-handed push-ups, smoking a cigar, laughing at me, telling me, come on, kid, take a swing. And I'm like, I'm only 12 or 11. He goes, hey, you know what the most important thing in life is? And I'm like, oh, my God, don't answer wrong. I look at his gold watch and went, money, because he's a millionaire. He goes, no, stupid. He hits me in the shoulder and goes, time. Time is the most important thing. I'm going, time? I'm only 11 or 12. I just want to go play with my brother. So I started thinking about it later on. I went, well, you got a point. Yeah, being on time, because he scared me to death. You got to be on time. Yeah, I get it. Yeah, be on time. Go to school. Do your chores. Show up at dinner. Yeah, be on time. Don't miss your dates. You know? And then as I got older, I went, time. Yeah, right, time. And now, I'm sure you guess what time is to me now. Time is time. I wish I had 300 years, man. I got so many things I want to execute. And in this short period of time, man, I wake up every morning and I apply those seven things. Am I being disciplined enough today? Am I working hard enough? Are you digging what you're doing? Are you learning enough? Are you executing the plan you said? You said you're going to write a book? Write it. Don't say you're going to do it. You know how we have lists and lists and lists. Get those things done. You got to do it. You got to take action. And then communication skills. Like, you know, that's just, are you a team player? Could you be getting along better with your wife? Or, you know, whatever. You know what I'm saying? It's like, there's all kinds of ways that we could be improving in all these areas. RPS, that's a no-brainer. You want to be good at something, you repeat it over and over. There's no shortcuts. Look it. Zero equals zero. I tell the lazy and entitled people, zero equals zero. You do nothing, you get nothing. And if you do nothing, you're not taking care of you. Someone's going to have to take care of you, and I certainly don't want to take care of you. So do something. All these things are important. That's how you make it and stay successful. And obviously, healthy life is a wealthy life. Without that, you're nowhere. And be relevant. And that is my lesson to you guys. Thank you. I want to play one more song, if it will play. This is the encore, like in a rock concert, where I leave the stage and come back, but I'm not going to leave the stage. I pray to God this works. Let me see if this does. We'll see before I... Yep. All right, this was almost an intimidating moment. This is me recording a song with the Buddy Rich Big Band, and I'm going to go play with them in New York. It wasn't typical that a rock drummer would be playing a jazz song, but I had spent many, many years playing jazz, and so I told him I didn't want to play a rock song, I want to play a jazz song. So this is called Straight No Chaser, which is a blazing fast song. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. I'm so sorry about the mistakes with the technical thing. Have a couple glasses of wine, you'll forget ever happened. Listen, it's been an honor to come to Detroit and be part of your Real Estate One. And Ed, it's Carol, right? Oh man, I hope I get her name right. She's the one to help get me. She works with you guys. Saying it wrong? Well, anyway, Nancy Vogel also brought me here, who is the person who hired me to do this thing for you guys. I want to thank you guys for being here and letting me entertain for you. I want to thank the soundboard. I want to thank the guys at the soundboard here. Mario, thank you. Sorry, it was a technical thing. I think it was on my end. Steve, who did the lights. Chris, who did the sound. These guys are super professional. Matt, Murphy, and Phil. I want to thank Ed Premier from Premier Productions, who does my videos, and he's here filming. So you guys are in, you're going to be all over the web. I want to thank Mike Premier, who's the hands-on editor of Premier Productions, Mateus, Eleni, and Mike Brink. And once again, man, thank you so much. I'll see you. I'll come out and talk and hang out with you. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you, Kenny. What a great ending and a great start for our party tonight. It gives us some good momentum, some excitement. So the bar is open. The food should be there soon, if not already. So enjoy the rest of your evening, and thank you all again. Thank you.